now rushing o'er us like a flood. There the wretch and vilest ones stand adopted through his blood. O mount of grace, to thee we cling. From the law hath set us free. Once and for all, on Calvary so, love and justice shall agree. Praise the Lord, the price is paid, the curse defeated by the Lamb. We who once were slaves by birth, sons and daughters, now we stand. Oh, well of joy is mine to drink, for my Lord hath conquered death, victorious forevermore. The ancient foe is laid to rest. Alleluia, Christ is King, alive and reigning on the throne. Our tongues employ with hymns of praise.
Well, good morning, church. Welcome to Church of the Redeemer. We are so glad you are here with us this morning as we come to worship our Savior, our God, and our King, and our Redeemer. Welcome again to Church of the Redeemer. We exist here to exalt Christ first by gathering those from our community, by grounding them in the gospel, by growing them into disciples, and then going together to make disciples of all nations. My name is Matt. I'm part of the staff team here at Church of the Redeemer. It is my pleasure to be here worshiping here with you this morning. If you are a visitor, we want to give you a special welcome this morning and ask you to please make sure you stop by the welcome table out in the lobby. We have a gift for you we'd like to send you away with. We also have a keeping in touch form. If you want to fill that out for us, we'd love to stay in touch with you, know how we can connect you to the life of the church as we go. Also, the church email is in the bulletin. If you have any questions at all, this goes to anybody. If you have any questions at all, feel free to email us. We'd love to be able to connect you with the right ministry people and answer any questions that you might have. We have just a couple of announcements this morning before we begin our worship. The first one is, as many of you know, during the Christmas season, our church family likes to look for ways that we can bless other people. So, on December 3rd, from 9 a.m. to noon, the men and boys of our church, I think it's age second grade, third grade and up. Yeah, second grade and older, we're having a work day. We're going to go bless some folks by raking leaves and doing some light yard work. We'll meet here at the church and caravan to the various houses, those that are close to the church. You can sign up on the church website. We'd love for you to come to this. Also, very briefly, the regular Friday morning men's prayer breakfast will not meet this week because of the Thanksgiving. Now, let's take a moment as we go into our worship service to prepare our hearts to worship our God. Our gracious God, our Heavenly Father, our Sovereign Lord, our King, our Redeemer, Lord, we come together as your people into your presence to worship you. Lord, we come not because we've decided we want to come find you, but we come to you because you came first to us. We come to you because you call us as your people into your presence to worship you, to exalt you, praise you. Lord, we pray this morning as we worship you in song, as we worship you in the reading and hearing of your word, as we worship you through our prayers, as we worship you through our givings of our tithes and offerings, as we worship you in every aspect of our service this morning. Lord, we pray that you would be at work transforming our hearts. Reshape us, mold us, point us towards our Savior Christ. Form us into the image of our Redeemer. May you be glorified and may we be transformed by our worship here this morning. In Christ's name we pray this. Amen. Church, if you will stand with me for the call to worship, if you are able. Our call to worship this morning comes from Revelation chapter 19. Then I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. The one sitting on it is called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes are like a flame of fire, and on his head are many diadems, and he has a name written that no one but him knows but himself. He is clothed in a robe dipped in blood, and the name by which he is called is the Word of God. And the armies of heaven, arrayed in fine linen, white and pure, were following him on white horses. From his mouth comes a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations, and he will rule them with a rod of iron. He will tread the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God Almighty. On his robe and on his thigh he has a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Brothers and sisters, this is the Redeemer we have come to worship this morning. Let us continue to praise and worship our King as we sing together, King of Kings. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one.
In the darkness we were waiting, without hope, without light, until from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King. And to reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation, you did not despise the cross. For even in your suffering, you saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation, Jesus, for our sake you died. Of heaven held its breath till that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who come to the the Father are restored. And the church of Christ was born. And the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel, shall not faint. By his blood and his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty,
seated. And at this time, I'd like to invite the Averill and Henson families to come and join me here to my right. Come on up, guys. Good to see you guys. All right, this morning we're excited to have two families come for membership this morning. Yeah, come right on over here. We have Don and Marilyn Averill. You can raise your hand, let us know who you are. And Darwin and Sarah Henson. And these dear folks have recently taken our LINK course here at Redeemer, found out who we are and what we do. And they have met with a commission of our elders and expressed their faith in Jesus Christ, that they know He is their Savior and their Lord, and want to publicly come to you today to express their faith in Jesus and their desire to be members here at Church of the Redeemer. So, Don and Marilyn, Darwin and Sarah, I have five questions for you. It's the same five questions we've gone over several times. The first three questions regard your relationship with our Lord Jesus Christ. The first question asks, do you acknowledge yourselves to be sinners in the sight of God, justly deserving His displeasure, and without hope, save in His sovereign mercy? Do you? The second question regarding Jesus as your Savior, do you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ as the Son of God and Savior of sinners? And do you receive and rest upon Him alone for salvation as He is offered in the gospel? Do you? Third question is Jesus your Lord. In other words, do you now resolve and promise in humble reliance upon the grace of the Holy Spirit that you will endeavor to live as becomes the followers of Christ? Do you? The last two questions regard your relationship with Christ's church. Question four asks, do you promise to support the church in its worship and work to the best of your ability? Do you? And then do you submit yourselves to the government and the discipline of the church and promise to study its purity and peace? Do you? Well, we praise God for bringing you all here to Redeemer. And I'd like to pray for you all now that God would use the gifts He has given you for His glory here at Redeemer. And I want you to know that you have a church family you know, at the end of the service today, please come and greet these two families. You know, when we have community time here in a moment, and of course, as we leave, greet these families. But let's go to the Lord and just pray for you guys and give thanks. Our God and Heavenly Father, we thank You so much for Don and Marilyn. We thank You for Darwin and Sarah and for bringing them here to Church of the Redeemer. And Lord, as they have professed their faith publicly today, may they continue to take this same gospel out the doors of this church to a world that needs Christ. We pray that You would use them mightily here at Redeemer and in our community for the gospel's sake, God. And may we as a church family come alongside them to love them well, to encourage them. May we as elders shepherd them well, as deacons serve them well, And as church members, may we encourage them unto love and good works. We give you thanks for adding to our number. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And church, as we continue in our worship service together, we come now to the point of our service where we will worship our God and our King by the giving of our offerings and our tithes back to Him. We know that God doesn't need our resources, but God invites us to participate in the work of His kingdom by giving back a portion of that which we have received. The ushers will pass baskets that we can give. You can also give online at redeemerweb.com. You can mail your check into the church office. Variety of ways to give. The important thing is the heart of the giver. As we prepare our hearts to give, remember 1 Chronicles 16:29, which says, "Ascribe to the Lord the glory due His name. Bring an offering and come before Him." Let us worship the Lord through our giving.
Depths I cry to you. In darkest places I will call. Incline your ear to me anew and hear my cry for mercy, Lord. Were you to count my sinful ways, how could I come before your throne? Yet full forgiveness meets my gaze. I stand redeemed by grace alone. And I will wait for you, I will wait for you on your word. I will wait for you, surely wait for you, till my soul is satisfied. So put your hope in God alone. Take courage in His power to save. Completely and forever won by Christ emerging from the grave. And I will wait for you, I will wait for you on your word. I will rely, I will wait for you, surely wait for you, till my soul is satisfied. Now He has come to make a way, and God Himself has paid the price, that all who trust in Him today find healing in His sacrifice. That all who trust in Him today find healing in His sacrifice. And I will wait for you, I will wait for you through the storm and through the night. And I will for you, surely wait for you, for your love is my delight. And I will wait for you, I will wait for you through the storm and through the night. And I will wait for you, surely wait for you. glory lie. I will wait for you, surely wait for you, till my soul is satisfied.
Our supplemental scripture reading this morning is from the book of Isaiah. In Isaiah 53, we read of this prophecy of the suffering that the Messiah would endure. This prophecy from centuries before, pointing forward to Jesus, of the suffering that he would endure to redeem his people. So hear God's word from Isaiah 53. Who has believed what he has heard from us? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us to peace, and with his wounds we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned, every one, to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that is before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. And as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living, stricken for the transgressions of my people? And yet they made his grave with the wicked and with a rich man in his death, although he had done no violence and there was no deceit in his mouth. In just a moment, Adam is going to preach on this very topic from the Gospel of John, of this beginning to unfold. But for now, we come to our time of our service where we recognize there was a reason that Jesus had to endure this. There was a reason that we needed a Redeemer, and that is because we are sinful people. So it is good and right that we take a moment in our worship service to confess our sin. This morning, we will confess our sin silently. So take a moment to recognize your own sin. Confess it before God. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, a brief moment of silence can feel like so long, and yet we recognize it is not near long enough to confess all of the ways we have transgressed against you. Everything that we have done that we ought not do, everything that we ought do that we have not done, sins against ourselves, sins against our neighbors, and always sin against you. Lord, we confess our sins. We confess our sins corporately. We confess our sins individually. Lord, we recognize our deep and profound need for redemption. Lord, we cannot pay this penalty that is due ourselves. We cannot make things right ourselves. Lord, we know that you have sent your Son. You have sent the Redeemer, Jesus Christ, to pay the penalty that we could not pay, to accomplish the redemption we could not accomplish, to bring us back into fellowship with you. Lord, you have saved us. We could not save ourselves, but you have saved us. And we praise you and thank you for this. In Christ's name we pray, for his sake. Amen. Hear now this assurance of pardon from God's word. From 2 Corinthians 5, "For our sake he made him to be sin, who knew no sin, that in him we might become the righteousness of God." Church, if you're able, please stand. We're going to sing together a song of response, "O Fount of Love."
amount of love divine that flows from my Savior's bleeding side, where sinners trade their filthy rags for his righteousness applied. Mercy cleansing every stain, now rushing o'er us like a flood. There the wretch and vilest ones stand adopted through his blood. O mount of grace, to thee we cling, from the law hath set us free, once and for all. Love and justice shall agree. Praise the Lord, the price is paid, the curse defeated by the Lamb. We who once were slaves by birth, sons and daughters, my Lord hath conquered death, victorious forevermore. The ancient foe is laid to rest. And hallelujah, Christ is King, alive and reigning on the throne. Our tongues
you to greet one another for our community time, and as you do, children are dismissed through the fifth grade.
Good morning, Redeemer. Good morning again, and it's great to see each and every one of you joining us in worship today. Of course, my name is James Barefoot, and I serve you as one of the elders here at Redeemer and have the honor of leading us in prayer this morning. So if you would please join me. Psalm 93, 1 through 2 says, "The Lord reigns. He is clothed in majesty. The Lord is robed. He has put on strength as his belt. Yes, the world is established. It shall never be moved. Your throne is established from old. You are from everlasting." In our God, in Revelation 5, we have the picture of your throne, and there's a bowl there with the prayers of the saints. And it's to you, our God, we lift our prayers this morning, knowing with full assurance that you hear and answer. In Matthew 28, Jesus gave us the command to go and make disciples of all nations. Our Father, we have these who are doing this work, and we bring them before you this morning. In our presbytery, Lake Tilray Presbyterian Church, and its pastor, Chip McCauley, bless him in his steady preaching and teaching of your word. Work in the hearts of the people there to hear and obey the scriptures and share the gospel that many in that community will be saved. Wendy Eunice is hard at work with campus outreach. Lead her as she encourages and guides those in her area of responsibility. We pray for your blessing upon her and husband Dean in their walk with Christ. Mick and Rachel Donahue have been ministering in Spain. Father, guide them as they seek wisdom and direction about future ministry in that area. Father, Peter Eck is pastor of the Atlantic City Church Plant. Bless him in teaching and preaching your word. We pray for the ministry to the community through their Christmas store, and that this would serve for many to hear the gospel and come to know Christ. We continue to pray for Daryl Timberlake and Harold Cole as they plant a church in Indian Land. May the gospel go forth through this church, and may many come to know Christ. We lift the work of Abby Cates with Youth for a Mission in New Zealand. Their passion is to know Christ and make him known. Work through Abby in fulfilling this mission. Here at Church of the Redeemer, Father, we bring Ed Schroeder and the Finance Committee as they help in leading us to be faithful stewards of the money your people generously give to the work at Redeemer. Guide them, the deacons and elders, as the budget is finalized for the coming year. In the sphere of government, we pray as instructed from 1 Timothy 2:2 for David Willis, our local North Carolina representative, and Janet Yellen, Secretary of the Treasury, that the decisions they make will lead to peaceful and godly living. The Navy of the United States is an important part of our national defense. We are thankful for those among us who have served in the Navy, and we ask your blessing upon those who are serving who will not be at home during the holidays. Father, Cheryl Brown has physical needs due to recent issues. Would you provide an accurate diagnosis of the cause, and may she and Tim know your comforting presence? We lift Lou Hunley, who needs healing from the flu, and ask you to bring healing to her. Lou Holmes continues to have problems with an irregular heartbeat. Provide for her in this need. For Rose Gooch in her pregnancy, provide good health for her and her baby. We pray for Sandra Slifer's parents' salvation, that they would know the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ. And Father, as Pastor Adam comes to preach about your journey to the cross. May you bring afresh to our hearts the greatness of your grace and love in Christ for us. And it's in Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Brothers and sisters, if you'll take your Bibles with me open to the Gospel according to St. John, we're going to look at chapter 18, starting in verse 39, moving to chapter 19 and verse 16. Last week's sermon was titled, "I Find No Guilt in Him," but that was part one. Today's sermon, again, "I Find No Guilt in Him," part two. It's amazing. Pilate keeps saying that over and over. "I find no guilt in Him." With that in mind, if you're able, I invite you to stand in honor of reading of God's holy word. The Lord Jesus once said, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear." John 18, verse 39. "But you have a custom that I should release one man for you at the Passover. So do you want me to release to you the King of the Jews?" They cried out again, "Not this man, but Barabbas." Now, Barabbas was a robber. Then Pilate took Jesus and flogged him. And the soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and put it on his head, and arrayed him in a purple robe. They came up to him saying, "Hail, King of the Jews," and struck him with their hands. Pilate went out again and said to them, "See, I am bringing him out to you, that you may know that I find no guilt in him." So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, "Behold the man." When the chief priests and the officers saw him, they cried out, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and crucify him, for I find no guilt in him." The Jews answered, "We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die because he has made himself the Son of God." When Pilate heard this statement, he was even more afraid. He entered his headquarters again and said to Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave no answer. So Pilate said to him, "You will not speak to me? Do you not know that I have the authority to release you and the authority to crucify you?" Jesus answered him, "You would have no authority over me at all unless it had been given to you from above. Therefore, he who delivered me over to you has the greater sin." From then on, Pilate sought to release him. But the Jews cried out, "If you release this man, you are not Caesar's friend. Everyone who makes himself a king opposes Caesar." So when Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out, sat down on the judgment seat at a place called the Stone Pavement, and in Aramaic, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation of the Passover. It was about the sixth hour. He said to the Jews, "Behold your king." They cried out, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priest answered, "We have no king but Caesar." So he delivered him over to them to be crucified. The grass withers, the flowers fade, but the word of our God stands forever. Pray with me. Oh God, as we enter into the magnitude of your passion for us, as we enter into your suffering, may we see how far you went to love us to the uttermost. That you came all the way down to where we are, took upon our flesh and our blood. And even though you were in the form of God, you did not consider equality with God a thing to be grasped. But you took upon the form of a servant, being made in our likeness. And you were obedient to your Father, even to the point of death, even death on a cross. Oh God, open our ears, open our hearts to receive the things of God. Remove every distraction from this place. We ask it in Jesus' precious name. And all God's people said, amen. Friends, please be seated. Do you remember the Old Testament story of Joseph, right there at the end of the book of Genesis? You know, Joseph, as we read that entire passage, we recognize that he actually suffered because of the sins of other people. Think about it. He suffered because of his father's favoritism, right? He suffered from his brother's jealousy. His brothers threw him into a pit and then sold him into slavery. Why does this guy get the coat of many colors and not us, right? He suffered from Potiphar's wife's lies. Joseph tried to be a righteous man, literally ran out of his shirt to get out of an ordeal he shouldn't be in. She lied about it. He suffered for that. He was put in prison. And do you remember the cupbearer who promised Joseph that he would remember him when he got out of prison, but he forgot about him? And Joseph suffered from the sins of other people for years and years. But did God forget about Joseph? He didn't, did he? All of this was in the sovereign plan of God. God raised Joseph up. Joseph became the second in command of Egypt. In fact, God used Joseph to save Egypt and even Israel from famine. And we remember the story. Joseph's brothers came south to Egypt to get the food. And when they got to Egypt, they didn't recognize Joseph, but Joseph certainly recognized them. And think about what was going through Joseph's mind. Think about if you were in that situation, that you had suffered from the sins of other people, particularly these brothers, right, who sold you into slavery. And now you have all the power, second in command in Egypt. And if you wanted to, you could just squash them, right? I mean, you could just wipe them out. In the moment that Joseph's brothers recognized Joseph, they feared that, didn't they? They said, what is he going to do? And Joseph, I'm sure, through a very trying time, even the Bible describes it, his weeping in the process, God had grown him in his faith through that suffering. And he said this statement to his brothers. You probably know the verse that's getting ready to appear on the screen. This is Genesis 50, verse 20. Joseph said to his brothers, "Hey, as for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, to bring it about that many people should be kept alive as they are today." Think about that. You're in the presence of your enemies, yet you say, "You meant it for evil, but God meant it for good." There's something going on that's bigger than you, that's bigger than me. It's God's sovereignty, His providence in all things. Nothing is outside the control of God. And what the Bible teaches us, friends, is that God even uses evil to bring about good. And brothers and sisters, that's exactly where we are in our text today in John 19, because we are in the presence of maybe the greatest evil that's ever been committed, yet the greatest good comes from that evil. You know, there is no greater evil in the world than the execution of the world's most righteous man, our Lord Jesus Christ. Yet we could also say there is no greater good than the salvation of sin that is brought about by the greatest evil ever committed. The execution brought the forgiveness of sins for you and I. Today, friends, we find ourselves still in the midst of this civil trial. We learned last week that Jesus moved from his religious trial to this civil trial with Pilate. And we remember that the Jews, they're not really interested in a fair trial. They're interested in one thing, the execution of our Lord Jesus Christ. Yet they didn't want to do it. They wanted Pilate to do it. And though Pilate found no guilt in him, hey, great exercise. Just read the Gospels. See how many times you see that statement by Pilate. I find no guilt in him. Over and over and over. Even though he found no guilt in him, the Jews kept pressing. Friends, that's where we find ourselves today in this text. If you have your bulletin, look on the back. There's four major points of our sermon today that we're going to walk through. I find no guilt in him, part two. The first point we're going to look at is simply this. What I call, there's another chance to do right. Another chance to do right. Secondly, halfway is just not far enough. Thirdly, we'll look at the question, what did I just do? Have you ever said that in your life? What did I just do? And then fourth and finally, are you a friend of Caesar or are you a friend of God? Let's zoom in, friends. Verses 39 and 40, what I call another chance to do right. Verses 39 and 40 of chapter 18 say, "But you have a custom that I should release one man for you at the Passover. So do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?" They cried out again, "Not this man, but Barabbas." Now Barabbas was a robber. Have you ever been in a situation where someone offered you another chance to do right? Maybe you're a child growing up in your house and you disobeyed your parents, but your parents had grace on you and they said, "You know what? You did wrong this time. I'm going to give you another chance to do it right." Or you had a teacher that you got your math problem wrong. "Oh, let me give you another chance in corrections to get it right." We all enjoy that, right? Another chance to get something right. You know, Pilate is in this situation. He's in the situation where he knows that Jesus is not guilty. And he's trying his best to present the Jews another opportunity, not to kill this man, but to do what is right. And not only would that give him an opportunity to do what is right, but it would get Pilate out of a mess, wouldn't it? So he says, "You know what? I find no guilt in this man. There is a custom that we have at the Passover. There is a custom to release a prisoner, to show mercy, to show grace. Certainly, if I brought up a man who is not only a robber, but a murderer," as we read the scriptures, we find that Barabbas is a murderer, "surely the Jews would want to release Jesus, the one I find no guilt in, and they would never, ever want to release a robber, a convicted murderer. Hey, it's another opportunity to do what's right. I'm bringing this to you again. Which one will you pick? Because I find no guilt in this man." And I'm sure to Pilate's astonishment, his bewilderment, they said, "We want Barabbas. free Barabbas. Free the one who is convicted of robbery. Free the one who is convicted of murder. And you can imagine what's going on in Pilate's mind. Are you serious? How far are you going to get this man named Jesus? The hostility towards Jesus was so profound that they asked for a convicted murderer to be released. Why? Why? You know, in the Gospel of John, this question has already been answered. Why? We'll show you. This is from John chapter 3, verse 19. We'll put that on the screen. The Lord Jesus says, "And this is the judgment, that light has come into the world, and people love darkness rather than the light, because their works were evil." This is talking about the total depravity of mankind. The man seeks that which is unrighteous, seeks darkness, and runs from the light. In fact, here's what Romans chapter 8, verse 7 says. "For the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God, for it does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot." Friends, what we're seeing here is the mind of the flesh. We're seeing people love darkness instead of light. As R.C. Sproul said, "This was the hour for the serpent to bruise the Savior's heel. This was the hour when Satan was having his way." And yes, they were headed to bruise the heel of the one born from woman, the Lord Jesus Christ. So obviously this didn't work. Pilate thought he had it figured out. Here's my way out. I'll present Barabbas. They'll want to free Jesus. That didn't work. You know, you think about it. He already tried. Last week he said, "You guys go and do it yourself." They wouldn't do that. This week, he gave him opportunity to release Jesus instead of Barabbas. They didn't do that. Okay, what's next? Point number two, what I call halfway is not far enough. Look back at chapter 19, verses 1 through 7. "Then Pilate took Jesus and flogged him." Scourged him is another word for it. "And the soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and put it on his head and arrayed him in a purple robe. And they came up to him saying, 'Hail, King of the Jews!' And they struck him with their hands. Pilate went out again and said to them, 'See, I am bringing him out to you so that you may know that I find no guilt in him.' So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, 'Behold the man.' When the chief priest and the officers saw him, they cried out, 'Crucify him, crucify him.' Pilate said to them, 'Take him yourselves and crucify him, for I find no guilt in him.' The Jews answered, 'We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die because he has made himself the Son of God.'" Halfway is not far enough. Have you ever met someone halfway? I'm from Bristol, Tennessee. As y'all know, remember when we had the kids and they were younger, oftentimes my mom or my dad, they would drive to Boone, and we would meet them in Boone, because Boone was about halfway between Charlotte and Bristol, and we'd meet in Boone, and maybe they'd take one of the kids for the weekend, or we'd meet in Boone, get them back for the weekend, but we met halfway, right? We met halfway. Maybe you were trying to buy a car, and you put up $30,000 and they wanted $40,000, so you met halfway. You paid $35,000 for the car. We compromise, we meet halfway all the time in life. Well, friends, this was Pilate's next step with Jesus. He told them to do it, that didn't work. He offered them Barabbas, that didn't work. What else could Pilate do to get out of this situation? He says, "Let me meet you halfway." You see, on one side, and we'll put this up on the screen, on one side, Pilate's view says he's not guilty, right? I find no guilt in him whatsoever. But on the other side, the Jews are crying out what? Crucify him. Crucify him. Execution. There's a big gap, right? There's a big gap between not guilty and execution. Pilate doesn't know what to do. So he says, you know what? I'll meet you halfway. But what does he do? He takes Jesus out to be scourged. We'll put this on the screen. He says, scourging is what I'll do. Friends, do you know what scourging is? It's a great question, John. Let's answer that. Someone takes a whip, has leather straps on it. On the ends of those leather straps are pieces of bone, pieces of metal. It's not just to hit the top of the skin. It's to dig into the skin and be pulled to rip the flesh, to expose the bones, to expose the arteries. In other words, it's a way to half kill a person. Half kill a person. See, he was trying to meet them halfway. Not all the way to execution, and certainly not freeing him by saying, you're innocent, you can go. He said, you know what I want to do? I'm going to beat this man half to death. And we are going to mock him. In fact, we're going to get a crown of thorns and beat it into his brow and let the blood run down both sides of his face. We're going to put a purple robe on him. He calls himself a king. We'll give him the color of royalty. Oh, we're going to come bow down. Hail, King of the Jews. Oh, we're going to mock you. And we're going to slap him right in the face. How pathetic is this guy? And then Pilate has all of these things done to Jesus, and he brings him out thinking to himself, I've met you halfway. I don't find any guilt in him. You want him executed, but look at this man. I find no guilt in him. See him in his pathetic condition. He's scourged. He's crowned with thorns. He's mocked. He's yelled at. Behold the man. And he's saying to the Jews, do you really think a man in this condition is a threat to you now? Isn't this enough? Isn't halfway enough? Can we compromise? Yet verse 6 says, when they saw him, they said, crucify him! Crucify him! You see, halfway was not enough. Even though they are beholding the perfect man, what humanity is supposed to be without sin, even though they are beholding the Son of the living God, even though they heard the governor say, I find no guilt in him, they love darkness rather than light, and they wanted more halfway. Well, that's not even close enough. Crucify him. Go all the way. So Pilate says again, you take him because I find no guilt in him. Then verse 7. The Jew says, but we have a law. You see, he should die because he's a blasphemer. He claimed to be the Son of God. What? Pilate hears these words. He claimed to be the Son of God. And he starts backing up. He starts backing up. And he asks this question, what did I just do? Look at the text, verses 8 through 11. When Pilate heard this statement, he was even more afraid. He entered his headquarters again and said to Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave him no answer. So Pilate said to him, "Will you not speak to me? Do you not know that I have authority to release you and authority to crucify you?" Jesus answered him, "You would have no authority over me at all unless it had been given to you from above. Therefore, he who delivered me over to you has the greater sin." Look at verse 8. Look at verse 8. When Pilate heard this, he was even more afraid. He claimed to be the Son of God. What did I just do? I took a man who might be the Son of God and I just scourged him. I just crowned him with thorns. I just mocked him and hit him in his face. What did I just do? I am terrified in this moment. Do you remember in the other Gospels, specifically in the book of Matthew, Pilate's wife tried to steer him away from Jesus? Do you remember this? Here's the verse. We'll put it on the screen. Matthew 27, 19. "Besides, while he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent word to him, 'Have nothing to do with that righteous man, for I have suffered much because of him today in a dream.'" Pilate, wake up. What are you doing? Well, you're not listening to your wife. Right, husbands? You're not listening to your wife. He's scared to death. His wife is telling him. The Jews are now telling him he's the Son of God. So Pilate brings him back in for more questions. Where are you from? Where are you from? Jesus gives no answer. And it's at this point we remember much of what Matt read just a moment ago from Isaiah 53. When you think about Jesus giving no answer, remember this verse. We'll put it on the screen. Matthew 53:7. "He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth." Pilate gets upset with him for not answering. "Jesus, don't you know I have the power to release you? Don't you know I'm the one that has the power to crucify you?" As if this is supposed to be troubling to the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus says, "You know what, Pilate? You don't have any power except that power be from God." We remember passages, friends, like in Isaiah chapter 40, when we read that the nations are like a drop in the bucket to God. Think about that. If you ever want just one chapter of the Bible to talk about the majesty and the power of God, just read Isaiah 40. It says, the nations are like a drop in the bucket to God. In other words, all that the nations are clamoring and raging to do, that's nothing to God. It's like a little drop in the bucket. That God is so much greater, he's so much more powerful than the nations, and in this case, even Pontius Pilate. He's saying, "Pilate, listen, you need to understand that you're the creature and God is the creator. God is the potter. Pilate, you're simply the clay." And Pilate, what you are doing, what you're allowing, is evil. But God is getting ready to take that evil and to use it for good. The Bible says that Jesus came into his own and his own received him not. The Jews clearly rejected Jesus. And then if you look at verse 11 of this text, Jesus answered him, you would have no authority over me at all unless it had been given to you from above. Therefore, he who delivered me over to you has the greater sin. Jesus talks here about the levels of sin, that this particular sin is greater or lesser than other particular sins. Here's what our catechism teaches us about this. We'll put it on the screen. It asks, are all transgressions of the law equally heinous? In other words, is every sin at the same level of being heinous? And the Bible says no. All sin is against God, but some sins are more heinous than others. Some sins in themselves and by reason of several aggravations are more heinous in the sight of God than others. And here Jesus says that the Jews, the law was given to the Jews, the promises were given to the Jews, and the Jews are the ones that handed them over to Pilate. Jesus is saying that for them, the ones who delivered them over to me, or to you, Pilate, they have the greater sin. Did Pilate sin in this? Absolutely. But Jesus talks about the greater sin that's been committed. And from here on, friends, Pilate continues to try to release Jesus. He wants Jesus released, but he has one more obstacle. It's our fourth and final point. He has to decide, is he going to be a friend of God or friend of Caesar? Look at verses 12 through 16. From then on, Pilate sought to release him. But the Jews cried out, if you release this man, you are not Caesar's friend. Everyone who makes himself a king opposes Caesar. So when Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and sat down on the judgment seat at a place called the Stone Pavement, and in the Aramaic, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation of the Passover. It was about the sixth hour. He said to the Jews, behold your king. They cried out, away with him. Away with him, crucify him. Pilate said to them, shall I crucify your king? The chief priest answered, we have no king but Caesar. So he delivered him over to them to be crucified. Friend of Caesar. Friend of Caesar. Friends, that was a formal title in Roman politics. If you were a friend of Caesar, it officially declared that you were a political supporter of the emperor. And if you were not a friend of Caesar, oh my, watch out, you might be executed. So, since Pilate had been appointed by Caesar, the Jews knew this, and they used this argument against him. Pilate, if you let this guy go, you're not a friend of Caesar. Because whoever makes himself a king speaks against Caesar. Now, you remember last week how I told you that Pilate already had done three things that had already frustrated Rome. Rome had decided that Israel could have some of their religious independence, but they were still governed by Rome. Yet, Pilate had attacked that religious independence three times already, and he had been reported to Rome three times. There was a one time where Pilate made busts of Caesar and put them on the head of a pole, which was against the second commandment of God's people, because that was idolatry, because Caesar was known to be a god. He had stolen money from the temple treasury to build a water duct. They complained about that. He made shields with Tiberius the emperor imprinted on the shields. Again, known to be a god, didn't sit well with the Jews. So what was happening was the Jews were complaining back to Rome at least three times. And Rome was getting frustrated with Pilate, that he could not rule these people well without constant confrontation. So Pilate had to decide, do I want this reported back to Rome? Do I want the fact that I'm not a friend of Caesar reported back to Rome? Because Rome's getting very impatient with me. What am I going to do? And he had to make a choice. Am I going to be a friend of Caesar? Or am I going to be a friend of God? This is John chapter 15. We'll put it on the screen. Jesus says, "You are my friends if you do what I command you. No longer do I call you servants, for the servant does not know what his master is doing. But I have called you friends, for all that I have heard from my Father I have made known to you." See, the Jews were pushing blackmail. They knew that Pilate didn't want to have a bad name in front of Rome. If you do this, Pilate, you're not a friend of Caesar. He had to decide, am I going to be Caesar's friend or am I going to be Christ's friend? What's the word in the scene, behind the scenes? Crucify him! Crucify him! You want me to crucify your king? We have no king but Caesar. Friends, if you ever wanted to see a full rejection of the kingdom of God from the Jews, there it is. We have no king but Caesar. Jesus was bringing his kingdom. We have no king but Caesar. What happened to Yahweh? What happened to God? We have no king but Caesar. Dear friends, Pilate then delivered him over to be crucified. Friends, what can we take away from this text? I hope many things. First of all, I want you to see in this text, just like Joseph, what was meant for evil against Jesus, God meant it for good. I want you to know when the Jews chose Barabbas, they meant it for evil. When scourging was not enough and they pushed crucifixion, they meant it for evil. When Pilate, who had actually good judgment because he knew he was innocent, but had absolutely no courage, when he decided to be a friend of Caesar and not be a friend of Jesus, he meant it for evil. But none of this was a surprise to God. None of it. Because God took the greatest evil ever committed and he turned it into the greatest good that the world would ever know. You see, where sin did abound, grace did much more abound. For because of the death of the Son of God, dear friends, you and I can now have eternal life from our sins. We can believe upon the Lord Jesus Christ and be saved. Christ's blood can wash us whiter than snow. And finally, I want you to see this. Do you see how far Jesus went to love you to the uttermost? Do you see the suffering, the bleeding, the pouring out of humility that Christ went through in order to love you and me to the uttermost? God did not spare his own son, but he gave him up for us all. Christ demonstrated his own love for us in this, that while we were sinners, Christ died for you. He was wounded for your transgressions. He was bruised for your iniquities. All we like sheep have gone astray, but the Lord laid on him the iniquity of us all. Oh, dear friend, turn to Jesus. If you don't know him, his arms are open wide even today. Repent of your sin. Embrace him as your Savior and Lord. For the believer, know how much Jesus has done for you, how much that God used evil to bring about good for you. Dear friends, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the time in your word today. We thank you for how far you went, Jesus, to love us to the uttermost. And how, Father, you did not give us second best or third best. You decided not to spare your own son, but you gave him up for us all. Oh, thank you. Oh, thank you, God. We see, Lord, the evil done in this world, yet we see how you used it to bring about good, that where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. Now, as we close this service, may we sing unto thee the praise that is due to you. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen. If you're able, please stand with us as we sing together, Overcome.
to die, poured out for all mankind. God's only Son, perfect and spotless one. He never sinned, but suffered as if he did. All authority, every victory is yours. All authority, every victory is yours.
This morning, wonderful worshiping with you here at Redeemer. If you're visiting with us, please join us in the lobby. We have our greeters team there. They'd love to greet you and send you away with a little gift from Redeemer this morning. Friends, receive now the benediction of our God. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and may the love of God and the fellowship of His Holy Spirit be with you all now and forever.
the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony.